Hello, everybody, and welcome back to the Bunker TV show podcast thingy. Hope you've enjoyed those that you've watched so far. Got a cracking show for you today, about an hour's worth of fun and local what's going ons. Amazing to be joined by everybody's favourite frontman, come landlord, come educational whiz, Barry Hyde, and a couple of his students, Toby and Ruby. We'll be chatting to those very soon. We've also got some archive footage from Bunker Sessions. We've got some of a couple of songs by the wonderful Faye, Fantarrow. We'll talk about that and the Fight for Faye campaign a little. But without further ado, please welcome my good friend, Mr. Barry Hyde.
Hi, Kenny.
How are you doing?
I'm all right, mate. How are you? Good.
I'm fine, thank you. Thanks for squeezing us in your amazingly busy schedule.
The feeling is reciprocated.
Yeah. I think when we've spoken off the record, off the camera, off the mic recently, telling me, you know, you've got loads going on. How are you? Is everything coping okay?
Yeah.
You look stress-free. You know, all these
I've just been in the baker's oven.
Right? Oh, right, okay.
Well, that's the best way to get the panacea of life. Yeah. Go and have one of their breakfast rolls.
Yeah, that'll fill you up till
they're getting cheaper.
At least February.
It's marvellous. You get one of their sausage sandwiches and the sausages get hotter.
Yeah. As you eat them.
Yeah, it's incredible.
Great. You could market that and it'd be cheaper than a hot water bottle, wouldn't it, with today's energy crisis? So today, although we're going to touch a little bit on the music because you've got a little bit of interesting news about you, but you know the main focus of day was on Name,
yes,
which is has been, we're now in its second full year, Northern Academy of Music Education.
That's right, yes.
Can you give us I mean we spoke on the show, mm-hmm, just as it was setting up, I remember that,
yeah,
and you were like, you know, I've got some sort of hot off the press news, and it was, you know, really exciting,
yeah,
for somebody who, you know, involved in the local scene like we are, to see young people come through and learn from you is great. Yeah. So tell us a little bit about it.
Well, I was thinking about this earlier, actually, because the first time I ever taught music was in the bunker when I was about 16. I used to come to Dave Murray's youth project.
Yeah, yeah.
And, you know, some of the participants, the members, would become tutors. So it was, there was Dave Brewis and Pete Brewis who had been brought in as tutors, and then I got taken into the fold as a guitar tutor, teaching mainly G major, you know, but like, you know, beginner level. And I really enjoyed teaching, actually. And then obviously we formed the band. We met in the bunker. That's when I met Jaff and Ross. And then we kind of went on our merry way, really. And occasionally I'd do some like visiting masterclasses in schools and colleges. When the band started to slow down, it became apparent that I needed to do something with me time. So it was, my mother was like, you should start doing private lessons. And I put me thing on social media saying, anyone want guitar lessons, piano lessons, whatever? And then I got an email from Peter Lee College.
Okay.
Interested in doing a job for us. Like standing in for a tutor. Yeah. So I was like, okay, no qualifications. I mean, I did a BTEC in music.
Yeah.
But I was able to get in and I was teaching performing arts. So basically playing show tunes on the piano with loads of performing arts students. They're all very extroverted and it was great. I was like, wow, this is weird. Started teaching in a primary school. I was the music man, you know, I'd come in.
From down
all all the kids would just love me because I wasn't doing anything academic with them, teaching them songwriting. I was doing hymn practice with 250 kids, you know. I'd not long been playing festivals, and then suddenly there's just loads of primary school kids and I'm getting them, I'm singing hymns with them. It was like, wow, where's this going, you know? Started teaching this place in Gateshead called Academy of Music and Sound, and I was a tutor there. Firstly doing level three, then I did me BA, then I was teaching on the degree. And my boss is a guy called Dan Donnelly. One day was like, do you fancy setting up a music school? And I was like, nah, not really. I'm quite happy here. I was teaching here and there. It was quite easy for me. You know, like it was, you could just kind of go and do your lessons.
Yeah.
Get a lot of enjoyment out of it, then just kind of go home.
Yeah.
But you know, we started talking about it more seriously. And, you know, that was kind of the genesis of what we call NAME, yeah. Northern Academy of Music Education, and then a five-year period of trying to actually make it happen. So we found a partner university, which is Sunderland University, obviously, yeah. And then it was down to where we're going to teach. And we were looking at that hallowed place called the Manor Quay, which is now called North Shore. We were going to do it in there. And it was, at one point, I think I even had the keys.
Did you?
And we're going in there, and the university were, the university is great, you know, they're very thorough, and everything has to be done to the nines. So we were having to test the drainage, the roof, looking for asbestos, you know, working out how long the boiler was going to last. You know, it was like quite, you know, it was mad, really.
Yeah.
In the end, the university were kind of like changed their mind on what they wanted to do with that building. So we found ourselves effectively homeless after 3 years of trying to make it happen. So it could have easily just gone up in smoke, you know, or evaporated. So someone that's been advising us a lot is a local man called Paul Callahan, who's a great bloke. He's on a kind of personal level, I think he's put so much time and energy and passion into a couple of developments in the city that I think have really changed the game. Notably the fire station auditorium and the stuff that's going on in that area. I think Paul's been instrumental in that.
Yeah.
And he's a friend of mine. He's a lovely guy. He's a silky lad, you know, and it'd probably be fair to say that if he wanted to, he could be living in the Bahamas right now. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But he's not. He's kind of, he's emotionally attached and passionate about Sunderland. And I said to him, look, the Manor Quay's fallen through. And he was like, well, what about the Peacock? And I thought, what? What do you mean? It's like, the top floor. I said, well, that's just a music venue. He says, no, the top floor. I'm like, what's in the top floor? He's like, well, it's basically an apartment, with 8 rooms. So me and Dan went down to meet him, and he took us upstairs into what was the original landlord's apartment of the Londonderry Hotel, built in 1901. And it's like, it was in a complete and utter mess, you know, like it hadn't been used for 40 years, which has been around the early 80s. And it was full of detritus and rat droppings, like,
nice.
And there was black mold on the walls. Yeah. And we were like, so this is going to be where we're teaching. And we thought, well, okay, let's. So there's the venue as well. And the week after, he was like, how would you feel about taking over the pub? And I looked at Dan, and Dan was like, yeah, let's do it. And I was thinking, no, what? Like, taking over the pub? To teach music. This is crazy. But we kind of had no choice, to be honest with you. Of course, as soon as we started running the pub, we realised, firstly, how much work it is to run a pub. It's crazy. Put together, eventually, a great team headed by Cindy, my fiancé. So it's kind of like a family business. Her mum's in the kitchen, and then the pandemic hits, and we're having to launch a music school, which teaches a degree in music, when at the time it was basically illegal and virtually impossible to be a musician.
Yeah.
We literally had to market it on December 2020 when you weren't allowed to perform in public. We thought, this is dead. It's dead in the water.
Yeah.
Dan rings us. Dude, what? We've got some applicants. I'm like, what do you mean? It's like, they've come through on UCAS. I'm like, okay, excellent. So we started doing Zoom interviews, because that was very common then, wasn't it? Zoom interviews. To be honest, I quite miss that, because it's a very efficient way of getting to know someone.
Oh, yeah,
you know,
definitely,
those days seem to be gone now. But so we cracked on. It was stressful. We're coming out of the pandemic. We're renovating this top floor. And England are playing today, right? Oh, should I not say that? No.
they
could be.
Today.
Doesn't matter, you can cut that out. But anyway, I remember we were sorting the top floor out. My brother, Dave, who's the drummer in the Future Heads, is a bit of a handyman. He does all sorts, but he's a really good painter and decorator and landscape gardener.
Yeah.
And he was doing the renovations.
And salad grower?
Occasionally, from time to time. That he aspires to be.
Yeah.
So he's like, we're like restoring all the walls, pulling up the floorboards, doing loads of work, transforming this space. Mm-hmm. And it's like, we need doors. Yeah. So I'm like, we need FD30 doors, fireproof doors. Went online, found some. When England were in the final against Italy a couple of years ago, it was class. You know, we lost, but it was a great night in the yeah. pub. Stayed up very late, 8 o'clock the next morning. I've got your doors. I'm like, where are you? I'm outside your pub. I'm like, oh. So I drove down. Probably shouldn't have. Probably should have got a taxi. But went down. There's a big pile of doors. He just left them on the pavement. I'm like, okay, I'll just grab them. The 18 stone each. So the final kind of hurdle was carrying 10, 18 stone yeah. doors to the top floor of the Peacock. And that was when we earned the right to christen Birdland Studios. And I would be, and that was quite a long story. I'm sorry about that. But
no, it's nice. I mean, the reason I asked you that open ended, I knew it would go up a little while. So obviously, fast forward now, a couple of years, you had a really successful first year yeah. and then recently your second cohort came yeah. on, and despite student numbers dropping kind of around the region, around the country,
yeah.
You've done well because yeah. of, and do you think that's because of this sort of unique setup and obviously yours and Dan's pedigree?
I don't know. I mean, I think when you're running like basically a university business, mm-hmm. you know, you've got to think about what the decisions that are being made are by the students, yeah. you know, and it's like some people want to go and live in Manchester because it's Manchester. Mm-hmm. Or move down to Brighton, or there's lots of degree courses in music, very well established. Paul McCartney's got a school, mm-hmm. do you know what I mean? Performing Arts, Lipper. So we kind of, our strength is we're a small business. We do really care. I mean, I'm not saying that other degree courses don't, but we genuinely care about the development of our students mm-hmm. and love to, and have personal involvement with that, because we don't have, you know, 50 students per year group. We've got 25 students all together. Yeah. So I think people who want to kind of have a bespoke, personalized
yeah.
kind of experience of doing a music degree might come to us. And also, yeah, I mean, me and Dan are both professional musicians. We've got Pete Brewis from Field Music as our production lecturer. We've got some great tutors like Mark Jackson, who's an amazing heavy metal drummer, Nick Jennison, who's like a real wizard guitarist and vocalist, and just a great, he's got a massive like online following with the Lick Library and whatnot. So we've put together this kind of offer that I think is strong. We've also mm-hmm. created like quite a cool campus in Birdland Studios. The students get to use our venue in the Peacock, and we've got a really nice room in the fire station. We teach on St. Peter's. Yeah. And, you know, it's like I'm still kind of in a state of disbelief that it actually happened, because it almost didn't happen so many times, and yeah. it could have easily gone pear-shaped, you know, even in the first year. But yeah. we're cracking on. When I think this is week 9 of the first trimester of the second year. So we go up to Christmas, and then we push through to the end of the year.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, huge well done for getting to where you've done now. Without the pandemic, it would have been, you know, a very sort of tricky thing to do.
Yeah.
And, you know, the uniqueness is, it's very, very Sunderland, if you know what I mean. It, you know, the because they're getting that personalised touch and they're going to be involved, I think often university students are maybe separate from the community, because yeah. they're almost kept apart for whatever reason, because yes. through the delivery.
Yeah.
So it's great to see that, and we hope that we'll see many of these students coming in here and kind of and out and about in Sunderland and trying yeah. to make a name for themselves.
This is what it's
footsteps.
All about. Yeah, this is what about, yeah. yeah, it's kind of like we're really delighted with the students that we've got coming through. It's great to be here with Toby and Ruby today so they can have a chat about, they're putting on an event soon. Mm-hmm. And also they're going to do a couple of songs, and yeah. it's great to be involved with them, you know. I teach Toby piano at the minute. Ruby does PPP with Dan. Okay. It's kind of singer-songwriter stuff, but Toby's coming on great with his piano playing. He's almost got the first Bach prelude down.
I remember you saying that we were talking about one of our staff here, James Bork, and you saying that.
Oh yeah.
So it's for, you know, for students to be able to identify what their you know, area of expertise and their area of things that need to be developed, or the things they'd like to be, and to be able to get that guidance is certainly unique. I'd imagine that if it was at a you know, a bigger campus, for example, it would be like, well, look, there's the syllabus, there's the content, kind of get with the program or get out, I suppose. Yeah.
And there's a lot of, I wouldn't say it was lazy, but quite like old school approach to doing music courses, where you basically force everyone to learn a bunch of songs, and it never works. You know, like there's only ever one drummer, maybe just two bass players if you're lucky, and then it just ends up being like
five guitarists.
Yeah, we just don't do that. You know, like we've kind of trying to bring a fresh approach to, because, you know, at the end of the day, it's very expensive to do a music degree, and I think it should be personalised. You know, because when you turn up at Glastonbury, Michael Evers isn't like, where's your diploma? Do you know what I mean? So it's like, we have to prepare them to, I think, give them the opportunity to try out all the different areas where you can get work in the music industry, just to make them more skillful, more enthusiastic, really. Because that's the real talent, is being interested. And now, you know, I'm 41 now, and there's been times when I've completely lost interest in music. And through those times, I wouldn't even class myself as a musician, just someone who used to trying to find that kind of passion again, you know. So,
what you say, you know, it's that passion. It's the opportunities have got to be there for them locally, and fortunately, the city's kind of, you know, developing, which is great.
Well, you know as much as anyone what it was like 15 years ago in Sunderland compared with how it is now. The developments that are going on are incredible, you know. And yeah, we feel, and I'm sure you feel, that with the Bunker, very much part of that, you know, like the infrastructure of the Sunderland music scene stroke industry. You know, it's like there's a lot of real grafters in the city who are, you know, really pushing it.
I think if you go back, you know, the halcyon days of the sort of mid-noughties, when every kid wanted to be in either the Future Heads or the Arctic Monkeys or whatever, and, you know, it was great at that time that so many young kids were coming to the Bunker and really being inspired by you guys. But, and because, although there were loads of venues putting, you know, kind of below par gigs on, that was really it. It was probably quantity over quality. Whereas now, you know, after the pandemic, where it's difficult to get people out of the houses, but the talent just seems to be, you know, it's astounding when you see you know, the musicians that are churned out by Young Musicians Project,
and the young
people that are coming through the City of Sunderland College. There are just so many artists there. And I think, you know, that's the first part, but with some of the big developments there, there's some infrastructure there, and I think that's the big sort of difference now, that people can see stuff happening around the city and going, right, okay. And that's why, obviously, these young people have wanted to come to Sunderland, partly.
I don't know. Why don't we find out?
Yeah. Well, before we go over to them, I'm going to, you know, we'll all revel in a bit of your wonderfulness. We're going to watch, just so people can see, you know, look back. It's not that long ago, really, when you brought out that first album.
Oh, the solo album.
Yeah. Which we all love here. And we spoke about it on the year before, and it was our album of the week once, I think. Patrick, bless him, absolutely loves it as well, don't you, Patrick? Patrick loves Sugar. So we're gonna play Thundersong, which was recorded at the Miners Hall.
Yeah, I did a session with my good friend James Hutchinson up in Silkswith. He's got this great little studio up there.
Beautiful up there, yeah.
It's just great, you know. He's got a nice acoustic piano, and this is a song that has three chords, but it's three chords, but they're looped in four. Okay. So you basically, the first chord progression is the first three, and then the first, and then the second chord progression is the second, third, and the first and second. Right. Just to fit you in. Yeah. For your information.
Okay. see if you can spot that chord progression, get your pen and paper out and write it down. This is Barry Hyde live at the Miners Hall with Thunderstruck. Thundersong.
Thunder.
Rolling, James. Thank you. stay together, living in the light, staring at the stars even though they're not in sight. We're gonna live forever, we're gonna dance all night. Showed me the door. I've never hurt like this before. Never hurt like this before. We can't decide the weather. Looks like it's going wrong. The heavens open and sing a thunder song. You run away like it don't belong. You run away like it don't belong. Under the sun, today I feel like I am just a little boy. I've got so much to learn and so much to enjoy. But I'm making big decisions, so many big decisions. I run away like I don't belong. Under the weather, under the sun, we're making big decisions, and if we get them right, stay together, living in the light, staring at the stars even though they're not inside. Gonna live forever, we're gonna dance all night. We talk about the weather, looks like it's going wrong. The heavens open and sing a thunder song. You run away like it don't belong. You run away like it don't belong.
That was a wonderful Barry Hyde, live at the Miners Hall with Thunder Song. did you spot that chord progression? I'm sure you sorted. So I'm joined here by Barry and two of his students, Toby and Ruby. Hi, guys.
You all right?
Hello.
All right. So obviously we've been talking for a long time, because Barry can talk the hind legs of a donkey like me. And you've been sitting there patiently, so thanks for sitting and listening to that. Hopefully it gave you a bit of background to you know, the man, one of the men behind it all, and his passion and whatever. So, yeah, although it might be quite awkward, what did sell Sunderland a name to you when you were choosing a place, Toby?
Well, for me personally, just if you look on the website, like that's at the base level of getting involved, obviously, like finding the find out the basic information. Like, it just looks like nothing that, like, nothing else that was being offered to me at the time. The kind of breakdown of the course in terms of like how we do genre studies and production, and then the PPP, which is the personal progression pathway, which, like Barry was saying before, like you get like a, you get assigned a tutor, and you basically just focus on whatever you want to focus on to be like, to be able to progress like your own like musical journey, basically.
Okay.
And then like, just looking at that, it's so like tailored to you.
Yeah.
Like, for what you want to do, like, rather than going and sitting in a lecture hall with like 60 other people who know how to play guitar and finding out, do you know what I mean, like how to do skills and stuff, like when you like, if that's not what you want to do, it's like, this is just basically perfect for like having a course that's tailored so perfectly to like each student, and you feel so like personally addressed by what's going on. And the tutors have like a really excellent approach to just to kind of like showing, never, they don't have
they never have a clue.
they never try and dilute your vision for what you want to achieve.
Don't tell you, oh, do this.
It's never, you never go to them with an idea and they come back with, well, you need to change this, this and this. It's always just like advice around how to like kind of concentrate what you want to do instead of like diluting the idea.
Excellent. Ruby, I imagine you'll probably say what he said. How's your first, you know, September, October, November, like kind of 3-4 months so far, your first year?
Yeah.
How's your first 3 months gone? What have you, what's a bit, you know, high points? I imagine there are no low points. Would you just give us a bit of like background how that's gone?
Well, we've been working on an event that we're doing. So we've started doing that from the get-go, really. We just started planning that. And that's been going really well. It's on December the 14th, is it?
December 14th, yeah.
Didn't want to get that wrong. And yeah, we've been doing that for quite a while. Our PPP as well, as you said.
So what's your PPP focus?
I'm doing with Dan looping. So he's talking.
You're a loop pedal.
Yeah.
Excellent, right.
And then I'm writing a song with Dan. He's helped me with the lyrics and everything. And then he's helped me to do the looping. So we started off with like a key for what we wanted to put the song in. Right. And then like the little melody thing for the loop. And it's great.
Had you tried looping before and sort of struggled and feel, or was it something that you thought, actually, I'd really like to do that? And just gave you the opportunity to get somebody to show you?
No, Dan was just like, do you want to do looping? And I was like, yeah. Why not? And he's really good at all that as well, because he does that in his band and everything. So it's really cool.
He's a master of looping.
Yeah, it is. Really,
I mean, although it's not necessarily a new phenomenon, if you can do it well, it adds so many different new kind of angles to you, to your performing. Do you see it as something that you're going to take into your sort of live work going on?
Yeah, I think definitely, because like it just like it makes it as if you have a band with you, basically, because you can do the drums and you can do like a little bass thing and then have a little melody, and then you're basically set. It's like you've got a little band with you, so.
But you don't have to pay them.
Yeah, exactly. It's just like free for me to do.
Hint of a Welsh accent there.
Yeah.
Whereabouts?
South Wales in Newport.
South Wales. Okay. So, I can't wait to come. What brought you to Sunderland, and how, you know, what's your first impressions? What your impressions of Sunderland over the last few months?
Well, I've been here a year because I did another course in Sunderland, but I'd never heard of it, to be fair, before I come up here. I didn't really know about Sunderland, but ever since I've been up here, it's been really good. Like, I didn't even know there's a beach or anything like that, or any of those things. Like, none of that. Yeah. I never thought it would be up here.
Is Google not working, Newport?
No. Don't have signal in Wales.
Don't have signal in Wales. So, Toby, your stuff, your music is using tech, using kind of, you know, electronics. Talk me through a little bit about the creative process of your music.
Well, this kind of project that I'm doing at the minute, it's called the New Romantic Era. That's the name that I
go out on.
Yeah, kind of perform under. And that's like a reference to the influences that, like, the music that's influenced the music that I'm making at the minute. Kind of like early 80s synth pop. Mm-hmm. And I make that on a computer. And then I play synth live, like over the top on like a live performance. And in terms of like what drew us to that kind of period, it's just I think there's a kind of undeniable magic about that period in the early 80s to the mid 80s, where you have like all of what Tony Wilson's doing at Factory Records and with Joy Division, and then obviously New Order, kind of culminating with Live Aid in 85. I think there was just kind of a real, just something you can't explain about that period that I kind of wanted to try my best to recreate in the music. Good. So
when were you born?
I was born 2004.
So I was born in 1981, and it was a magical time.
Yeah, I mean, although that kind of sounds strange to some people, come, but you know, if so, that's 40 years ago. You were that scene, and if I think when I used to come in the bunker in the 90s, we would play stuff from the 60s, but the 60s even then seemed like, you know, millions of years ago. You know, the 80s seems quite sort of modern, obviously because of some of the kind of hints and the sounds, but it wasn't 40 years ago. Do you who are you inspired by kind of in today's world?
Well, bands that make kind of similar stuff to what I'm trying to do, like the 1975 Blossoms, but in terms of like lyrically, I looked at obviously John Cooper Clarke's influence, mm-hmm. like kind of can't be ignored on like poetry. Yeah. I have like a real fondness for that. Stuff by Brian Bilston, who's like only really kind of come into prominence over the last few years.
The poet?
Yeah, the poet.
On Facebook?
Yeah.
Yeah. I think he's great. Mm-hmm. He's kind of quite playful.
Yeah, yeah.
Funny. Mm-hmm.
It's that kind of the ignoring of rules around language is what he kind of really promotes, Brian Bilson and John Cooper Clarke. Mm-hmm. And that's kind of what I try and replicate in my lyric writing. And a lot of it does start as kind of like fragments of poetry and other little bits, and then it gets like transferred into a song. That's kind of my how I kind of construct the songwriting.
Okay. Ruby, who are your influences?
I'm heavily influenced like by the Beatles, the Kinks, Stones, Stone Roses.
Patrick cheering in the background. Yeah.
Just all that kind of stuff, really. Okay. I like Britpop kind of stuff as well.
Okay. But do you see yourself in, you know, at the end of your degree, forming a band or being able to go out solo?
I don't know, because I like when we've been in college and stuff and things like that, because I've always done music, I hate being with other people because I hate people telling me what to do. Yeah. I just want to do my own thing, and like I can do it when I want then, do you know what I mean? I don't have to be with people. But then I suppose if I did the looping thing, I can just do...
Have 10 friends, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Don't need anyone.
Yes, binary numbers somewhere in an electronic device.
But yeah. Maybe a band, like, maybe, if I could be, like, proper in charge, because I just hate, I don't know.
People.
That sounds bad, yeah. Don't like anyone.
Well, on that bombshell. So you're both going to do a performance for us, and we'll come back and have a bit further chat. We're going to play a couple of songs for you now. First of all, I'm going to chance to listen to another of Barry's songs. We're going to listen to his cover of the Prince song, Sometimes It Snows in April, beautiful song. And we're also going to have a song by Faye Fantarrow, one of her tunes here live in session at the Bunker. She's done a couple of sessions here. We love Faye, she's been coming in for years. She's got there's a campaign at the moment to raise nearly £500,000 so she can receive some innovative cancer treatment in America. So we'll have a listen to this song, and then we'll mention the campaign. The campaign at the moment, they've raised about 25-30%. If you search Fight for Fear, there is a Just Given link. You may or may not have heard about it, but anyway, this is Barry Hyde, Something Snows in Heaven, and Faye Fantarrow with Ego.
A whole lot better. Tracy, 'cause he was my only friend. Those kind of cars don't pass you every day. I used to cry for Tracy, 'cause I wanted to see him again. But sometimes life isn't the way. Sometimes it snows in April. Sometimes I feel so bad, so bad. Sometimes I wish that life was never ending. But all good things, they say, never last. Springtime was always my favorite time of year. A time for lovers holding hands in the rain. Now springtime only reminds me of my Tracy's tears. Always cry for love and never cry for pain. Cry for love and never cry for pain. He used to stay so strong, unafraid to die, unafraid of the death that left me hypnotized. Now staring at his picture, I realize no one could cry the way my Tracy cried. Sometimes it snows in April. Sometimes I feel so bad, so bad. Sometimes I wish that life was never ending. But all good things, they say, never.
You got this Stockholmania trip. You've been thinking a lot with your could I be any clearer than this? But you're not ready, no, you're not ready. And boy, you've been off and running your mouth. You've been talking too loud. Do you think we could tone it down? But you're not ready, no, you're not ready. 'Cause I walk so you go on, and now you're holding the wrong end of my gun. Trigger pull, bang, bang, now you're done. 'Cause you weren't ready, no, you weren't ready. Oh, 'cause I walk so you go on, and now you're holding the wrong end of my gun. Trigger pull, bang, bang, now you're done. 'Cause you weren't ready, no, you weren't ready for this. I no, you weren't ready. Little girl barely stood on her feet, so I guess it that makes me feel sweet. Well, you can come get a taste and you'll see. But you're not ready, no, you're not ready. And I know that this all must sound crazy. I flipped your world on his head and he's hazy. So you can run back to your friends with your tail between your legs. 'Cause I rock so you go run, and now you're holding the wrong end of my gun. Trigger pull, bang, bang, now you're done. 'Cause you weren't ready, no, you weren't ready. Oh, 'cause I rock so you go run, and now you're holding the wrong end of my gun. Trigger pull, bang, bang, now you're done. 'Cause you weren't ready, no, you weren't ready. Drop down, hit the ground like flies, 'cause I'm bored of these boyish lies. Walk up to me, look in my eyes, and tell me, could you do better, huh? Drop down, hit the ground like flies, 'cause I'm bored of these boyish lies. Walk up to me, look in my eyes. could you do better? Drop down, hit the ground like flies, cause I'm bored of these boyish lies. Walk up to me, look in my eyes and tell me, could you do better? No, so you go run. Now you're holding the wrong end of my gun. Trigger pull, bang, bang, now you're done. Cause you won't ready, no you won't ready. Oh, cause I walk, so you go run. And then you held the wrong end of my gun. Now pull the trigger, bang, bang, now you're done. Cause you won't ready, no you won't ready for these.
Welcome back. After those two songs, Barry Hyde's last. We're gonna give him two songs. We could probably sit here and listen to it all day. But the wonderful Faye Fantarrow playing Ego live in this studio as part of our archive footage. All of it's on YouTube. If you want to go and find it, like, share, follow, whatever you do, that kind of thing. Barry, if we can just touch a little bit on your solo work, because I think you're finding a little bit more time somehow. I don't know where you're finding this time, but you find some time to write some new stuff. What can you tell us?
Well, I really want to make a Future Heads album. That's what I really want to do, because I love being in the Future Heads. And when we made our most recent album, it was kind of like a really amazing journey. It was a lot of work. I think we did about 300 hours of recording, and maybe it's about the same in writing. So it was a lot of graft. And it dawned on me recently that it's probably unlikely we're ever going to have that amount of time to get all getting together in the same room. We do it, and we rehearse the other night because we've got a gig next week. And I just love it, you know. So, but in terms of having that kind of creative excitement, I decided to make another solo album, and then there's a company called Company E, based in Washington, D.C. Because you know the link between
D.C. and T-Dub.
Yeah, because of, the Washington family.
Yeah.
I've done a few commission projects with this company, a guy called Paul Emerson. And he got one of them was, I wrote an EP for the Tall Ships.
Okay.
And we performed it on one of the ships. With a load of dancers, during that heat wave, you remember?
Yeah,
it was great. And amazing. Then I did like a composition for a video that was made by this company in partnership with Sunderland College. Mm-hmm. And then another one's come through, which is actually an album commission, and it's about the culture of the pit. So I've been buying loads of books about pitmatics and learning the language of the pits, and found loads of really old books about with mining ballads. And I'm using that as part of the inspiration for this album that I'm making, which is a kind of an electroacoustic album, not as personal as Malady, but it would, I think, stylistically fit in with that. So it's become a creative project. So I'm doing little recording sessions when I can, a lot of writing at the minute, and I'm really enjoying it. I'm going to produce it myself. I'm going to play all the instruments on it, hopefully. Unless I have to give out Dave a ring when I realise I can't play the drums. For longer than two bars. Be like, oh no, I'm going to play drums for two bars. I'm going to have to get a drummer. So that's kind of, I'm going to call it Yakka, the album. I'm enjoying it.
As in Pit Yakka.
As in Pit Yakka, but I'm not going to sing in like Pitmatic. I'm just going to sing how I would sing, but using some of the language.
Sounds
of
the innocent.
Pit. But yeah, it's like I'm thinking about doing a narrative about a person and his family, a pit family, who go through from him being a boy, going right the way through to him eventually being in charge of the wheel, you know, and the kind of the troubles of that world.
Obviously kids nowadays wouldn't know, you know, anything like, you know, what, how important that was to not just our area, but many other areas. But you know, so very interesting. Have you had to research and speak to the one from Mr. Gregson?
I was just about to mention him, you know, literally. Did you read my mind there?
I did, I knew where you were going.
So
I'm not going to tell you what you're thinking now, though.
A lot of people in Sunderland, especially in the music scene, will know Keith Gregson,
yeah,
because he's a songwriter, he He's written hundreds of songs. He's also a historian. Yep. And he's just one of the loveliest guys ever. And he did like My Family Tree and stuff like that, you know, like, because he's got access to all these archives because he's a historian. Yeah. So he's like, oh, you know, by the way, two of your ancestors died in the Trimden pit disaster. I'm like, really? Mm-hmm. So it's like, apparently one of them, 13-year-old and 17-year-old died in the Trimden pit disaster, suffocated. So I'm learning, you know, this kind of, there's a link to me personally and my ancestors too. But of course, in the Northeast, most of our ancestors were probably either sailors or ship, involved in shipbuilding or working in the pits. Mm-hmm. You know, like Weymouth Colliery was, I think, the deepest pit in Europe. Mm. Mining's been going on since the medieval times, and it was previously all owned by the church. And basically, up until very late on, miners were slaves, essentially. Mm-hmm. They would abscond. They were kind of owned by the church and then eventually by venture capitalists. And they were essentially, this is your contract. You're going to do this. We're going to pay you a pittance. And this, if you try and run away, we're going to find you and bring you back. They were basically slaves. It's fascinating. And also the pit ponies, you know, they were blind because they lived under the ground. But they had like this seventh sense. If you call it seven,
I
suppose I don't know how many senses they had, but basically there's loads of stories about these pit ponies coming to a certain point in the pit. And bearing in mind, you're talking hundreds of meters under the ground. These like networks of, you're in the dark. You got like, you know what I mean? Like the pit pony would stop. Come on, no further. Would not move. 10 minutes later, the pit collapses everywhere apart from where they are. You know, it's like this world that some people seemingly want to bring back. It's like they haven't got a bloody clue how horrific it was.
Yeah.
And at one point, children would like little children would work in the mines. Mm-hmm. And it wasn't until something like 1700s that children and women and men would basically all be working under the ground. It's crazy.
Yeah. Wow. So there is a tenuous link there, and good that you've brought it up. We'll have a, before Ruby and Toby join us for a performance, we'll have a couple more songs for you. We've got a live session here by the aforementioned Mr. Keith Gregson, Right Honourable Keith Gregson, live in room 4. And we'll also have the second song from Fear Fantarrow Boom. So
Fight on. every screen is like my Bible. It might sound blasphemous, but did you see the episode where his brains explode? And politics, it don't mean shit to me, 'cause I'm too young to know what all that means. No, none of it matters until your freedom shatters. The big bang shot by God's hand, the boomer generation have my lifeline, and I'm holding on, but the silence is done.
Hello everybody, I am Keith Gregson, and I am old, you can see that. Old enough to have seen the Beatles, which is a good thing. Old enough to have been involved in music for over 50, maybe over 60 years, and I've written songs for about 50 odd years. So first of all, I'd like to thank The Bunker for inviting me to do this concert here today. It's come at an appropriate time, because I've spent most of the pandemic putting my songs down, you know, for posterity, into a couple of albums. And one of them, the first one, it's with accompanied all the way through, and with tunes as well, is called The Man Who Could Not Sing. It's not about me. It's about a guy called Kideman, who was he was a cowboy at Whitby Abbey in the Saxon times. And the only person to write about him was a local lad from here called Bede, who was actually Saint Bede, who was born on what was called the Sundered Land, which is not far from here. And according to Bede, Kideman was the very first person to write a song in the English language. And the whole story of Kideman is told in this little song called The Man Who Could Not Sing. Alone by the fireside, his face and his feelings he would hide, dry with fear, for he knew that soon they'd ask him to stand and to give a tune. Then everyone would laugh with a ha ha ha, everyone would laugh at his tra la la. No one in the hall ever cared at all for the man who could not sing. Come on, Kideman, give us a song. Please make sure it don't last long. You can sing of love, you can sing of war. Don't be afraid when they laugh for more. Everybody laughed with a ha ha ha. Everybody laughed at his tra la la. No one in the hall ever cared at all for the man who could not sing. Then he went to his stable room, away from the maddening throng. He got down on his knees and prayed. He said, Lord, what did I do wrong? And when he was asleep that night, well, he dreamt he saw a light. It was an angel dressed in a robe of gold, saying, sing for me tonight. And everybody laughed with a ha ha. Everybody laughed at his tra-la-la. No one in the hall ever cared at all for the man who could not sing. Alone again by the fireside, come on, Kideman, the cynics cried. Stand on your chair and do your thing. You know we want to hear you sing. He stood, he sang. I sing of the Lord who gave me birth, sing of the Lord who made this earth, sing of the Lord of heaven above, sing of the Lord of truth and love. And nobody laughed with a ha ha ha, nobody laughed at his tra la la, And the cattle boy who had no voice made 100 people rejoice, thousands more in years to come, as he sang to them in the native tongue of the man who could not sing. Sing of the Lord who gave me birth, sing of the Lord who made this earth, sing of the Lord of heaven above, sing of the Lord of a truth in love, sang the man who could not sing. Kideman's song of the man who could not sing.
That was wonderful, Mr. Keith Gregson, Esquire, and Faye Fantarrow, both playing live archive tracks in the bunker here. Faye has a gig on tonight, or there is a gig in Faye's honour, to try and raise money for the Fight for Faye campaign. So please get down to Pop Rex if you can. Lake Poets are playing, Tommy Smith, Eve Cole, a number of other performances. There are still a few tickets available, so please, if you can make it down there, go and get yourself down. It would be a wonderful night. If you can't, then you can still contribute to the crowdfunder appeal, the Fight for Faye, if you look for that. We'll put details in our link, our comment downstairs. Downstairs on the page below. It's time now for the live performances from two of the students from NAIM. First of all, we've got Ruby Kelly, who'll be playing one of our own tracks, and she'll Something in the Water. She'll also be playing a cover of Sweet Dreams, and then we'll have the new Romantic Era on after that, playing a couple of tracks as well. So enjoy both of those. Here we go.
This is called Something in the Water. Brushing it off, it's time to kill. Is this just something that gives me a thrill? I don't think it will. I shovel it up, and just like snow, and you've got something under your nose, and doesn't matter though. Is it something in the water you think that it would ought to be? And I said, hey, 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 what's wrong with me? It's 3 a.m. and nobody knows what you're up to, where you could go, and do you think they know that it's something in the water you think that it would ought to be? And I said, hey, and hey, 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 what's wrong? Got down on my knees. You say you want me, but you're wanting to please. And I said, hey, 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 what's wrong with me? And I was looking to run. Yes, said I love you, but I love everyone. And I said, hey, 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 what's wrong with me? Is it something in I said, hey, and
this is a cover of Sweet Dreams by the Eurythmics, so I hope you enjoy.
Sweet dreams are made of this, and who am I to disagree? I traveled the world and the seven seas, and everybody's looking for something. And some of them wanting to use you, and some of them wanting to get used by you, and some of them want to abuse you, and some of them want to be abused. And sweet dreams are made of this, and who am I to disagree? I traveled the world and the seven seas, and everybody's looking for something. Some of them wanting to use you, and some of them wanting to get used by you, and some of them wanting to abuse you, and some of them want to be abused. Sweet dreams are made of this, and who am I to disagree? I traveled the world and the seven seas, and everybody's looking for something. Some of them wanting to use you, and some of them wanting to get used by you, and some of them wanting to abuse you, and some of them want to be abused. And sweet dreams are made of this, and who am I to disagree? I traveled the world and the seven seas, and everybody's looking for something. Some of them wanting to use you, and some of them wanting to get used by you, and some of them wanting to abuse you, and some of them wanting to be abused. Sweet dreams are made of this, and who am I to disagree? I traveled the world and the seven seas, and everybody's looking for something.
This is the New Romantic era, and this song's called Ball and Alley.
Cross the road with the cautiousness of a lollipop man and metamorphosis. Reconstruct what was left of the crossbar, adding revelness to your repertoire. And the remarkable nature of the act was dampened slightly by the fact you look like you've been to the bowling alley and you forgot to buckle in. And you can wait all week for student night, but it wouldn't be the same. You lusted for the lanes in a selfish way, refusing to return any other day. Walked out with a whimsical abandon, leaving me shoeless without a leg to stand on. And the remarkable nature of the act was dampened slightly by the fact it looks like you've been to the bowling alley and you forgot to buckle in. And you can wait all week for student night, but it wouldn't be the same. and still you piece together a party like you had a secrets event management degree. I've never seen someone tie balloons with such efficiency. Looks like you've been to the bowling alley and you forgot to buckle in. And you can wait all week for student night, but it wouldn't be the same. Looks like you've been to the bowling alley and you forgot to buckle in. And you could wait all week for student night, but it wouldn't be the same.
This next song's called Carol Vorderman.
I cling on to the consonants, I'm a voyeur for the vowels. You pick and mix your dress each week, I need the paper towels. I slow my blinks per minute, Rit. You are the play, pause and rewind. You are the stop and start, the counterpart, the double underlined. And when you reach for the numbers, I wanna go back to the 80s. And when you solve the equations, oh, I wanna give you babies. I'll be the discreet lipstick on your teeth, I'll be your last known location. I'll be the all-important, indispensable 78th rotation. All I can smell are the special guests, all I can taste are the transitions. You are the mint condition, first pressing, collectible edition. And when you reach for the numbers, I wanna go back to the 80s. And when you solve the equations, oh, I wanna give you babies. And when you smile at the camera, I wanna climb through the screen. And when you linger on the letters, it's like a smash cut in a daydream. And when you reach for the numbers, I wanna go back to the 80s. And when you solve the equations, oh, I wanna give you babies.
Right, thanks everybody for joining us. I hope you've enjoyed the show, whether you listen to it on 107 FM, on sparksunderland.com, or here or watch it here on YouTube. Make sure you're tuning again same time next week. A big, big thanks to Barry Hyde for joining us, to students from him, Ruby Kelly and Toby, New Romantic Era. Hope you enjoyed all that. Please go and find all of those artists on socials and watch, like, share. Go and support your local music scene. We'll see you same time next week. Thank you. Bye-bye.